morning, good afternoon for those of you in other parts of the world. Welcome to this societal chat, the favorite hour of every month. And today we're going to have fun learning from Prashant Mehra. And so let me begin by introducing Prashant. While he looks quite worried on the video, he's actually quite a handsome man, as you can see from this picture. And his passion is socioeconomic inclusion. He was the Social Entrepreneur of the Year 2020, the Schwab Foundation Award. So congratulations again, Prashant. There's a very interesting background, which we'll learn more about as we go along. But as we speak, he's building the Platform Commons Foundation, or PCF, which he will share more about. Essentially, the idea here is interconnected public platform or commons for agriculture, education, civic engagement. So it's really a global infrastructure as commons for multiple things. Of course, in a more specific way, building a platform for inclusive entrepreneurship, or PIE as it is called, the focus being how do you help marginalized micro entrepreneurs compete? They could be farmers, they could be artisans. And his partner in crime, Raghu, is also on the call today. His other partner in crime, Neelam, who's also a Schwab fellow, she is not on the call today, but three of them have put together some amazing stuff. Of course, his background is strategy, consulting, program management. He has run consulting operations in UK, Europe. Mindtree is an organization that he has spent a lot of time. He used to head social inclusion at Mindtree, continues to be associated in some ways with Mindtree, but he will share obviously more of his journey. I've been fortunate to have an amazing association with Prashant. I think I met him for the first time in 2017. I think it was April of 2017. And we were doing this workshop on Creative Million, and that is when we met for the first time. Mm-hmm. And together we jammed and we shaped the vision of how do you create a platform that can service 100 million farmers and artisans. And since then, I have learned a lot from Prashant. And so looking forward to this interaction today. So welcome, Prashant. You know about the Aspire Fellow. We are here.
Yes, absolutely.
And so with that background, I am going to stop the share so that you can see more of Prashant and less of the slide. So Prashant, what I would really love to begin with is I have always been fascinated by how you began all of this. Journey as a rag picker, those days, right? So tell us something about where it all began and how you got this idea. How did you land up with this whole platform thing, if you will, from roaming the streets? So tell us about the beginning of the journey.
Yeah, it's very, very interesting. And I think a lot of things have come together to make it happen. This whole thing started sometime in 2008. When I used to, I headed Mindtree's platform engineering vertical and ran that out of London. And I was doing a fairly large build out, $150 million build out for a single platform. And one fine day, this whole thought hit me. What am I doing with my talent? And the answer could have been anything. The answer was, I'm helping the rich get richer. These were the exact phrase that came back. That was very, very difficult to live with. And I didn't know what to do with it. And the one thing I decided, however, is that I will not justify anything to myself. Let me live with the discomfort. Let me not justify to myself that no, whatever I'm earning, whatever I'm doing is all good stuff. And that eventually led to a sabbatical. So I took a 2-year sabbatical. And which interestingly, so I'd always loved rural India. I never lived in rural India, but I loved rural India, the concept of rural India, the village, the romantic notion. And when it came that what should I do, India was not my first choice. I was afraid that if I come to India, I'll get too busy living my rural India life dream and I'll just settle there and chill. So my first choice was really go and work in Africa or Indonesia. Some opportunities were there, but VSO turned me down. They said, you're not qualified enough. So you overqualified for something, then underqualified for the other. So I was thinking I should be qualified for something therefore. And funnily enough, the day VSO said, you are not qualified to volunteer with us, the same day somebody from Delhi called saying that we are doing some work in supply chain in rural India and do you want to start? So this whole thing started from there. So a few days later, I landed up in Delhi. With the only thing I knew really was that I want to work in rural India. I didn't know agriculture. I didn't know what sector. And I didn't even know if I had the skills to do anything. So because as you said, all I had done was consulting and program management and technical platform architecture and things like that. 2 years into the village, actually, so the first thing I really did was, I said, the one thing I do well is a 3-week discovery. So that's what you have been taught. Go to a customer CXO office. In 3 weeks, you have to figure out and tell them what to do. So I said, I give myself 3 weeks in this village and I'll do a broad-based discovery. And in 3 weeks, a 2x2 matrix emerged with 16 project ideas. And 16 work groups in the village who were willing to partner on those project ideas. And it was obvious that it had to be agriculture. Just the sheer number of lives that was dependent on agriculture and so on, the potential of then scaling it out to other places. The fact that farmers already were investing large amount of capital. So about $100 billion annually is what farmers invest in growing the crops they grow. So it was, and I first learned I told myself that, you know, you're not working in a resource starved situation. You are in a resource surplus situation. You have people who have $100 billion of working capital and they're making it work. So 2 years later, I had managed to make an income impact of a factor of 4. So we had 4 times income impact. I'd started working with 5 landless labor. And by end of year 2, we were 700. We were spread across 5 villages. One of those 5 villages was about 300 kilometers south of the village I was working in. So the word had spread. And I was getting city sick. I loved it. I wanted a break. And I had 3 months. I had 3 months with me because while I was doing this, my wife was sitting in Bangladesh building mobile platforms for maternal health. And she was so we were both supposed to finish in December 2012. She was 3 months behind. So she said, I need 3 more months. You go do something. So I reached out to my then boss at Mindtree, a gentleman called Shubrato Bakchi. And I said, I am craving the city life. I want to sleep in an AC. I want to eat KFC chicken and drink Coke. And I want to write a book, right? That's what you do. You think you have arrived in life, so you want to write a book. And Shubrato is a prolific author. So he said, come. And so I came, went to Bangalore. He said, I lied to you. You cannot write a book in 3 months. You're welcome to stay. I'll give you food to eat. But you can't write a book in 3 months. It takes 1 year to write a book. So I think, why did you call me then? He said, I want to discuss an idea with you. Whatever you're doing with farmers, can you do something similar with rag pickers? So I said, let's start. let's figure out. So January of 2013, I did my due diligence again, found an organization, volunteered for them, got connected through them to a 55-year-old woman, a waste picker by the name Lakshmi, in an area in Bangalore called Shivaji Nagar. And I started picking garbage with her. And would do that, then select, you know, collect it at the end of it, sort it out, bail it, send it to a place called KR Market, where there's the informal sector. And that would be my nightlife. Because in the day, waste pickers are not allowed on the streets. So I would do that in the night, sleep through noon, get up and write my business plan to take it to the Mindtree board to say that we have the opportunity to create a livelihood platform. Because one thing I realized while I was starting to doing this scavenging with the waste pickers, both the agri and waste management look like supply chain issues. Both look like information asymmetry, access to markets. Both looked like that they were working at the fag end of the value chain. So both waste pickers, by the time the recycling happens and think of the value of that material compared to what they get for their paper and plastic and what the farmer gets for their raw produce, very similar ratios. Similar, you know, the number of hours of work you put in and so on and so forth. Hard physical labor, very low value capture. Because you are at the wrong end of the supply chain, you are not doing value add to your product, you are not aggregating, you do not have access to market. It was just staring in your face, and you're not doing product transformation. And so I said, man, we have this vertical in Mindtree called RCM, retail, CPG, and manufacturing. This looked like a CPG problem. This looked like a, you know, retail manufacturing supply chain problem. So why don't we build platforms to do that? And what you also realize around that is this, we coined this phrase called independent entrepreneur. We said India runs on independent entrepreneurs. What we call self-employed, they are not self-employed, because employees are paid salary. Employees don't take business risk. Employees do not have to worry about when the next customer is going to come from. They just got to show up for work and do what is assigned to them and it happens. None of these luxuries are available to the independent entrepreneur. They are actually entrepreneur. So self-employed is not the right term. And the moment we started saying they are entrepreneurs, life changed. All of a sudden, the previous 20 years of work experience became relevant to me. I said, farmer is the new customer, rag picker is the new customer, they run a business. I know how to consult with people to improve their business. I know how to build tech solutions to improve business. So I'm in the right space. So all of a sudden, as I was started seeing the similarity in the lives of the farmer and the waste picker and being able to correlate it to, you know, product value at supply chain, the idea of India livelihood platform emerged. And then it started off with working with waste pickers. We built out a platform. We went live in first 9 months and we threw it out while we were piloting. That ran a life of its own. We started doing the next rebuild and then a third rebuild, which we are on now with about 4 million people. Around that, diversified. We started realizing that I think a lot of reinforcement happened when I met Sanjay. Sanjay used to talk about his first thing I remember, he spoke about context intensive and context independent. There are certain things which are the same independent of what context you operate them in, and certain things are highly contextual. So I had started off by building a set of context independent things. I said an invoice is an invoice, a warehouse is a warehouse, product is a product, irrespective of context. The only context is there, we are building it for an organization who has one employee and whose annual turnover is $1,000 and not for a company whose annual turnover is $1 billion. So we are literally making a micro enterprise. We're reducing the size of the enterprise by a factor of a million, from a billion to, so we were all used to building softwares and solutions and for $1 billion enterprise. And we got to make it for $1,000 enterprise. And so a lot of those factors, so I think a lot of the reinforcement happened talking to Sanjay, that indeed there will be a building block which is context independent. And therefore you give yourself as well as others the ability to build context rich solutions on top of it. So I mean, a lot of it is still theory, right? It you have to make start. You feel validated when you talk to like-minded people. And I think that's what happened in this whole partnership with Raghu, Neelam, Sanjay through the years. And we started diversifying. You take the same constructs and build solutions for rag pickers, what we build, morph them into solutions for farmers, for artisans. And today for independent entrepreneurs, there are people who are not working with farmers, who are not working with, they're just running shops, who are just doing simple aggregations of stuff, little manufacturing. I don't even know their use cases, but they're able to use the software. The only thing with them is that they are also working with $1,000, $2,000, $5,000 turnover kind of businesses. I'll take a pause. Once I start speaking. Sorry. Yeah.
Because, you know, from your business to farms and to rag picking to building platforms, and coming to that point saying in the end I'm building a infrastructure for $1,000 company, that's the core, that's it. Now you can be $1,000 farmer, you can be $1,000 artisan, you can be $1,000 chai shop, be $1,000 anything. Because you know, I know that you have, and then of course you build this family of I got platforms, right? I got garbage, I got this, I got that, and so we'll go into that evolution. But I just, so as a part of the next to commons, to people, you've been like, I think in the last 4.5 or 5 years that I have known you, I have seen you pivot. Tell us something about what's going on in your mind. What's your mind? How do you make all these pivots again and again? And I know that currently also you're again going through pivots. So tell us more about how do you wire yourself for such rapid and big pivots? These are not minor pivots.
Yeah.
And tell us about some of the pivots also, so that we get the context of the pivot itself.
I think it is. I tell you, first of all, how do I gear myself mentally for the pivots? So I told myself that I'm building something that will start becoming relevant in 30 years. Why 30 years? So we said, look at Apache Foundation. When the first Apache server came, I think it was the late 80s or something like that. The Apache server. The Apache server first came in 80s. It's about 35-year-old. Apache Foundation formally is maybe less, 28, 26, something like that. So we said, and today you can't imagine after 30 years or 20 years of Apache 6, you can't imagine writing a piece of software without having an open source component from the Apache Foundation. So they're some of the best components, even better than the commercial ones out there, are sitting in the foundation as open source tools, but it has taken them this much time. So the first thing I really told myself that what you're trying to do is hairy, it's audacious, it'll take time. And the good part about your pathway, dear Prashant, is that you're building software. So it's very easy for you to leave legacy. It's going to be there in a repository and somebody else will run it and do new versions and new versions. If you look at the Apache versions, some of them will be in a version 80.3.6. I think they'll also, you know, the Commons platform will also one day become version 80.3.6. So in some sense, that has helped. That has helped in every time a situation has come up. I've managed to look back at the software, at the code base. Am I building the right stuff? Will this code base stand the test of time? Because it's very malleable. Right? Code is malleable. If you design it right, you can evolve it. So that has given me the confidence that the work I'm doing is malleable, is amenable to transformation. And if I can beat it for long enough and I build a long chain of tail of people in this movement, then it'll become another Apache Foundation. So that's the goal. That's the goal of the Commons, the Platform Commons Foundation. is to really become another Apache Foundation, except Apache builds open source software, which can be used by the rich and the poor alike. And in my mind, it's like saying you give a sword to a samurai and you give a sword to a farmer or to a peasant. Well, the peasant stands no chance. So you have to build solutions which are designed to give disproportionate power to the poor. And therefore, we'll talk later maybe about the license and the commons concept, etc. So this whole thing has really given me the mental makeup of not to get exasperated or tired when the next pivoting thing comes. The first such situation came very early on. I managed to convince the Mindtree board to really fund work for Wastepickers. But I knew that there isn't enough work to be done for Wastepickers. It's a very limited use case. And it had to become a general purpose livelihood education skilling platform. And try convincing that to the board. Every time you go for your quarterly review with the board, they'll say, show me some results with Wastepicker, then we will talk. So in fact, the whole I got thing came, and the way I solved that problem was by deciding to name everything I got. So while I got garbage is a very powerful name. I got crops, I got knowledge. I don't even understand what they mean, but the board felt very happy that if I'm doing something similar. And they said, do it. So you're doing something I got, okay. And I think that was the first maneuvering, really. So I sold the name I got. I noticed in one of the board meetings, some board member had used the word, I got this, I got that. And I took that as my license to do I got crops. And I repitched it and I presented I got garbage back, which was doing very well. In fact, if you Google me, you'll only see I got garbage results, because we did really well in those times with I got garbage and et cetera. And I think by that time, I got crops happen. I realized no more interviews, more work is to be done. But the second big thing that happened is when I think that was the most important pivot of all, was we hit 1 million beneficiary mark. And everybody, we said, we never thought that there'll be 1 million people on the platform. And we were operating in 7-8 languages and all kinds of some 400 social entrepreneurs, social businesses were there on the platform who were using and so on. And that's when we said that maybe we should give the platform to the government. Because if it's going to take us 10,000 rupee for transforming one farmer's life, and you have, if you're going to take us, say, $200 or $100, and you have 100 million farmers, we'll need you $10 billion. And in the country, if you have 100 million farmers, that's the number of farmers we have. We have 150 million farmers in the country. So obviously, neither Mindtree, CSR, nor our partners. We said, but the government has the mandate, it has the budget. We did the math. And but that meant that a whole lot of thinking in terms of platform ownership had to be changed, because the government would not run a public program on a private platform. So that led to a whole lot of discussions internally with the Mindtree legal team, with our auditors, with the IP people, with CSR funding. What if we were to give it to the government? Would it invalidate it to be a Mindtree IP? Would it? All of those questions came. We went through that. And we decided to work with the government and hand over copies of platforms to the government. That also forced us to create the platform commons license, because we didn't want the government to misuse the platform, sell the farmer data to private companies. We also realized that agriculture being a state subject, if we are wildly successful, we'll have 29 or 30 instances of the platform. And then you will lose network effects. So we decided that these platforms need to talk to each other. Like the country is a federation, the platform needs to be federated. So a lot of those decisions came, and I think that gave us amazing amount of energy and focus when we decided that we are going to give it to the government. It opened the door with the Mindtree management to open source it. It put the challenges to the engineers to make it as a federated model. And it involved conversation from all kinds of architects across the country. One of them being a gentleman called Pramod Verma, who we spoke to, who is the architect for India's the Aadhaar program. And a lot of the fundamentals of how to build a federated architecture came from there. And it gave a lot of energy to us. And we pulled this whole thing off. And a year and a half later, Mindtree got acquired by a construction company called L&T. And then that's when we exited Mindtree. That's when the and that was a very, very narrow tightrope walk. It could have gone either which way. I think we managed, thanks to all the work we were already doing with the government. And so we had a brand new board. They just acquired the company, a fairly hostile takeover. And here I was presenting my case to them saying open source the platform on which you have spent $5 million.
Yeah, it's
It's
a very fascinating transition that you build something inside a private business organization through CSR fund and then take it out as a public good, right? As a commons. It's a very unique case because there are many cases of people building something in the commons for the commons, but building in the private sector, taking it out for commons. And in the whole journey, it will be good to hear from you your thinking around scale, because I know when we jammed together to figure out how to do the Andhra Pradesh pilot, and then the whole discussion around you then going into multiple states beyond, and you know this Ashoka, and you're familiar with this model of control versus scale, and we have talked about it in the past. How did you think about, and that led to the creation of your whole platform commons license, which is a different form of license, on which we have argued a lot because of whether it's a good idea or a bad idea. But we would love to hear from you. Journey of scale, big pilots, platform common license, bringing a new control architecture. Why?
Sure. So journey of scale has been, I think, the most interesting of them all, and also the most conflicting in my own mind. In my first discussion I had with the Mindtree board, and with Shubhrato, who's been my mentor for a very long time, he says, knowing you, Prashant, if I ask you to build a car, not only will you build the car, you will build the highway and the petrol station and the rest and everything. And I said, yes, that's exactly the job. If you just build the car, my customer, the farmer, doesn't know how to drive the car. I got to build all the support structure around them. So if you just build a good business model for the farmer, for a particular crop or a particular value chain for a particular commodity, it's meaningless. Those business models exist. You go to NABARD site and there will be the model bankable project. They exist. How to do the ideal dairy farm, how to do the ideal atta company, and all of that exists. It's useless unless you do. But that's very, very hard work. That's very hard work. It's slow work. And it doesn't give you results off the bat. Because if you are building infrastructure before building the car, people will say, why is the car not operating? Why are you just building the roads? The second part grappling with scale has been about, you gotta get into the skin of every use case. So often people say that if a farmer has to earn $5,000, what'll happen to India's GDP? India's GDP will be $15 trillion at that scale. If 65% of the people, their turnover becomes fivefold. So the farmers, the informal sector contributes to about, you get the idea. So, but then you realize that what you're dealing with is food. And then you realize there's a tremendous opportunity for local commerce. So you start seeing the farmer as a consumer, the rural India as much as a consumer, as a producer. And all kinds of use cases come out of that. You start doing shops, you do cooperative societies, you network the shops for surplus sharing. The shops become warehouses, come distribution centers by themselves in a rural setup. So Otherwise, you will hit a rate limiting step somewhere else. So it's not just about the platform model per se. The use case itself needs to cater to that size. Right? It's I remember that movie from I'm bad with names. So what was that the wormhole, Matthew McConaughey, time travel wormholes?
Interstellar.
So his dad says 7 billion people, and they want each and everybody wants everything, which is so true. So when you think of scale linearly in terms of just multiplication, it boils down to 7 billion people and everybody wants everything, and they're also fair to ask. So your use cases need to become very, very nuanced to say that if you succeed wildly, is there room? Or will you end up in that state of 7 billion people, everybody wants everything? So where is that room, and how do you create, how do you leverage the room? And the room is there, malnutrition. India is malnutrition. So if you are doing food processing and supply chain, you got to find local markets. That's where the hunger is. You got to provide food where the hunger is. That may actually mean that your $5,000 becomes $3,000. But your nutritional security increases, the cost of food reduces in rural India, and that's okay. So that has been the second set of thinking. Constantly, every time we've done something, we've tried to do the full circle on the supply chain to find where it'll hit, where the market become a bottleneck, with the warehouse become the bottleneck, the storage becomes a bottleneck, what becomes. So for storage, for example, at one point in time, we did these nano warehouses. Rag pickers' houses were storage of home composting bins. So they sell home composting kits. We designed flat pack, IKEA-like flat pack structures, and we said, buy them a wardrobe. That is their warehouse. That's a nano warehouse. So the third thing really has been in terms of thinking of scale, is been working with the government. So we designed this program with this initiative called Programs to Platforms. And we've had moderate success. Andhra has been a great adopter till today. They continue to do. We're actually right now, as we speak, we are talking about a very interesting partnership. We will be helping them set up a development center of 30 engineers within the department. So we'll hire them, we'll train them, and they'll enhance platforms, the commons platform, and they will use it. So there's good hunger from the government, but huge amount of investment, very slow, got to find your sponsors very carefully. So we signed up with 3 states, 2 were very wishy-washy, and AP stuck. Through thick and thin, we've managed to do things together. We're also saying it may take 50 years, it may take 30 years, but let's do the plumbing. We are all about infrastructure. And when you do, right, the question that comes is that, to whose benefit is this infrastructure going to be? So tomorrow, if the platform is wildly successful, and if you have all the farmers of India putting all their inventory on the platform, what prevents corporate houses from hijacking that information? So unless you have rules built in the platform which will not allow monopolistic behavior. So in fact, one of the very first versions we built a license for, we said, because with software, open source software is, it's like a sword. It doesn't, it has no intent. It's a tool. So the intent has to be built into the license. So one of the very first terms we wrote is that X percent, that any organization or their sister concerns collectively can only buy less than X percent of a commodity from the market, which is exactly what the Essential Commodity Security Act in its past avatar was. You could, because other than that, if you don't do that, you will allow hoarding to happen. And the thing with technology is that whatever it does very efficiently. So if it does good, it will now do it efficiently. If it does bad, it will do it efficiently. So you started writing your values, so data, right? So when you look at today's large successful programs, they use data. Their biggest power is data, and not raw data. aggregate data. So a Facebook will very sweetly tell you your raw data is your property, but it's silent, it doesn't, but aggregate data is Facebook's property. All analytics, all anonymized data, all analytical data, trends, everything the Facebook uses to run its business. We said, what can we not then have a license where the user is the owner of raw data and a shareholder of the aggregate data? And 100% of the aggregate data belongs to 100% of the user base. And it's very easy to determine who is it, those things, because eventually it all boils down to what you can. We'll get into how you can do that technically, because you can pretty much tag every data item with somebody. So you know whether this is your data or not, whether this data has participated in aggregation or not. A third thing, for example, is value chains, right? So we have in our license given the right to the user community to determine value chain pricing. It's very specific. You've got nothing to do with commons. So we have a, you know, like a, there's a platform commons license and a platform commons agri license, which derives everything from the platform commons license and add agri specific rules to it. So by doing so, you are building ability to put your values, the reason we are doing this, and what we think will create success, what we think will not create success. You can put those things into software, which traditionally did not differentiate between values or the absence of them. So that's why we felt it's important to create a license. And it's still evolving, and it creates a lot of interesting concepts. So for example, let's say Sanjay runs a e-commerce company and sells artisanal goods. And Sanjay goes and onboards 200 artisan companies or artisan SHGs and 20 buyers. He will say, they're my property. Why should they have an independent existence on the platform and discover each other? And then we'll have to tell Sanjay, sorry, Sanjay, you are using the wrong platform. Then go to Shopify, do your own stuff, or et cetera. Because unlike an Uber and a Facebook and a this and a that, who can spend a lot of money to build traffic on the platform, the poor cannot. So the only way we can build traffic on the platform is where we see everybody's traffic as collective commons traffic, common traffic. If I'm a volunteer, irrespective of who onboarded me, I should be able to reach out and explore volunteering opportunities with anybody else in the platform. If I'm a farmer, irrespective of which NGO onboarded me, I should have the same right to explore opportunity across. If I'm a buyer who has an existence, I should be able to find any seller irrespective of which route I found. Now, this is a very touchy topic. And it's true, somebody is spending their own time and money. And our only argument to them is that you are anyway spending philanthropic money to come on the platform. So don't say that, you know, this is my buyer or my supplier or my artisan. This is somebody has donated money for you to do that. So, and in other case, the other argument, of course, is that when you share, you get back, which people understand. But it's a very touchy topic, and we open it. So every day you end up writing some clause, some variant without losing the essence of it. But the reason we decided to write a license like that is, how do you embody your value system? The reason we are doing what we are doing, how do you take those values and put it in something dead and inanimate like a software? So if you could write a digital constitution for this federation of platforms, then it is truly open because it's protected by the constitution. Till you can do that, you've got to control it. And otherwise, if you make it free without those controls, then it'll be like, you know, yet any tool, anybody can use it for any purpose.
Yeah. I know, and that sort of stirs up a lot of conversations, obviously not for today, but it's a very important topic that I wanted to the team to know that it is possible for you to think about licenses very intelligently. But of course, it requires you to understand the prevailing licenses very well, because there are interoperability questions, whether the licenses can work, supersede. And it's not as straightforward as it might seem to be. But I think it's an important question of values versus the license and what it permits, etc. You have been one of the people who's trying to shape the field of platform thinking, right? Bringing these concepts, these ideas. What have been your struggles in shaping this field?
See, I think the biggest struggle has been, not struggle, really, and maybe struggle also. Actually, two struggles. One has been, it's extremely painstaking to get partners along. And we see all the, some 376 odd social businesses who use the platform as co-creation partners. Everybody tends to, because they are not in the infrastructure business, building business. So it requires a big mental alignment, and B, also some amount of patience on their part to do that. So that's been a very, and it's not exhausting, but it's very, takes a lot of effort. A lot of the examples I gave about data sharing, not many organizations are comfortable with it, but you have to have that conversation. And you can't give up. You can't say, if you don't want, don't use my platform. So a lot of time goes in educating people. You've got to show them samples of, you know, what happens when you contribute with this data, what do you get in return, and what does the overall system shape up as, and why is it good for you, why is it good for your cause. Those conversations have to be happened. So that's been one really, really this thing, because people will tend to agree very quickly, saying, yeah, this is all very good. But when it comes to start using it, and therefore saying, okay, this artisan I'm onboarding or this farmer I'm onboarding will have an independent existence on the platform, people say, no, can for me, can you change it? Kind of things. The second thing has been, I think as you talk to governments or even impact investors and the general community that can help you scale, I don't think people have gotten over at all, even in the impact investment community, that trickle-down economics doesn't work. So people come back to you with all kinds of advice and use cases and even, you know, commercial models, which you are classically, you know, what's wrong with it? Just go, what's wrong with the current state of play? And often offer you solutions and conditionally, you know, right? So, and these are the people you are looking to scale with. So that whole trickle-down economics works, or the same models which have failed in the past, tweak them a little and they will work. That conversation sucks the energy out of you. And with that group, you can't educate. You gotta just, at least I've lost the, you know, there's sharp cookies. But the NGO partners, it's a question of, it's real education. These people know what they're talking about. A lot of them are the reason why we are in this state. So that's been a struggle, really, to see that at the highest level, the realization that the world needs something different, and we have kind of last 25 years failed, and the way economies could have emerged, that realization hasn't set in.
Thank you so much, Prashant. I know we are at time now, and so we could have gone on for hours with you, because these conversations are pretty simple on one end and pretty sophisticated on the other. But we are all a part of your network, like you are a part of ours. So a lot of us will get in touch as we move along in our journeys, and we will all learn together. So thank you so much. Very grateful for your time today.
No, thank you.
And looking forward to the 25 years ahead. As yeah.